When 30-year-old Gemma Sowers decided to have cosmetic dentistry to give her a perfect smile, it ended up affecting her big day.
When my wisdom teeth came through, I ended up getting quite a few problems with my teeth because of the overcrowding. My front teeth seemed to be more prominent than the rest, and the bottom were just all overlapping. I didn't really smile as much as I probably would have done. I was a bit conscious about how I was smiling.
Gemma decided to have braces to help straighten out her wonky teeth, and sensibly researched in her options long before her wedding.
I always knew that I'd like to have straight teeth for my wedding pictures, so that was always a goal. I came across an orthodontist who was offering a free consultation to discuss what my options were. I thought I had nothing to lose.
Gemma went ahead with the procedure. She had 5 teeth extracted and had braces put on her top and bottom teeth.
After about a year of the top braces being on, it was ready to have them off, and I was pretty happy with the result.
But the dentist never removed her bottom braces, and it wasn't until a routine checkup at an NHS dentist 3 years later that Gemma started to get concerned.
He thought, you know, as I did, that they should have been off after 16 months from extended pressure put on them. My bottom teeth were quite wobbly, and I've had 5 teeth taken out when I should have only had 4. I was pretty shocked and upset.
The clinic where Gemma had the braces fitted charged her £2,000 to try and rectify the problem. It was a temporary fix to get her ready for her wedding, which was now just months away.
It was a month before the wedding that I finally got the bottom train tracks off. But because my teeth were still so wobbly, they had to glue in a bonded retainer at the back to try and secure them so they didn't move.
When the wedding day arrived, not only were Gemma's teeth unstable, held in place by a hidden brace, she still had a large visible gap when she smiled, hardly ideal for the numerous wedding photos.
At the end, I was happy with every element of the wedding, apart from that, and I had a big gap. I did end up being conscious and sort of probably restricting my smile as I did before. I know that if I don't get it fixed, then the damage is only going to get worse.
Gemma is in London at the United Smile Centre to find out if anything can be done to fix her mouth. She's under the care of Dr. Carl Meinheim.
Here we have a 4, missing the 5 and the 6. What's normally happened when you lose the 2, the bones start to shrink.
Gemma has a CT scan to find out whether she'll need a bone graft to enable the implant to be fitted securely.
We need to increase the bone volume. It's got a little bit tricky. The lower jaw, you also have a nerve, the sensation of the lower limb. So we're limited to the length of implant we can place there.
Carl will need to review Gemma's scan before deciding what course of action to take. Next time Gemma's in the dentist chair, she'll be having her botched dental work. Gemma's early married life has also been affected by substandard cosmetic work. A tooth that was removed in error has left a huge gap in her lower jaw. If the gap were to be left unfilled, her lower teeth would spread out of shape. Today she starts on her journey to have the damage repaired by dental surgeon Carl Meinheim.
Gemma's case is not as straightforward because she has been without these teeth for 7 years, which means that the bone volume has shrunk in the area.
The bone will need to be replaced before a permanent implant is inserted. Carl takes some of Gemma's blood that will be used to create plasma-rich growth factor, or PRGF. The PRGF technique isolates the blood plasma proteins responsible for wound healing and tissue regeneration. It will help to stimulate bone growth in Gemma's jaw. The team spin the plasma out of the blood and then add calcium.
In about 5 minutes, everything is jelly.
While the gel forms, Carl prepares Gemma's mouth by giving her a local anesthetic. He removes the gum from around the bone to expose the air.
inside and feel it with vibration.
A guide screw will allow Carl to check to see if drilled the correct size hole.
Here we can see the guide pin coming out right in the middle of the temporary tooth, which means that that's ideally positioned where it is now.
After 30 minutes, the hole is the correct size, and the screw to hold the new tooth in place is fitted in. Carl places Gemma's new tooth onto the screw to make sure it fits.
So you can see when we try with the temporary tooth here, it's coming straight over the cylinder where we want it, so that's just position perfect here.
Once the shape of the tooth is refined, it's ready to be fitted. Carl surrounds the area with the PRGF gel made from Gemma's blood. The gel will stimulate bone growth. Once the new bone has developed, it will hold the implant securely in place.
With a bit of the membrane as well. Put on top of that. It feels like it's protection.
With the membrane positioned to protect the gel, Carl stitches it to Gemma's gum to hold it in place. Carl then fills the screw cavity with tape.
If you don't do this, you get bacteria, microbes from the mouth coming in here, and that means that there is
after just a couple of hours, Gemma's new tooth is ready for inspection.
Oh, it looks fantastic. Thank you. I see I've got something back in there.
Yep.
Great. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
The operation has been a success. Once the gel has grafted into her jaw, Gemma will return to have a permanent tooth.
In the past, I've been a bit wary of how I smile, so once the real tooth is on, I guess I'll be grinning from ear to ear.